Jesus, thank you for the privilege of being before you. We come before you with open hearts. God, we've come here to hear your voice, to hear what you're thinking and what you're feeling, to meet with the living God. Jesus, God, I ask that you would fill this room, that you would sweep through the room, that every heart would be touched, every heart would be moved. God, that there would be a true spirit of worship in this room tonight. Jesus, we love you. We set our hearts on you.
Thank you.
it shows our God is true. And there's a song rising from the valley. It's our response to you. There's a river flowing from the mountain that shows our God is true. There's a song rising from the valley. It's our response to you. You are God, God of all creation. The earth groans and longs to be with you. Where we are, our hearts are raised to heaven. Still, and the same voice that moved upon the waters says, come and have your fill. And in the stillness, I can hear you whisper, calling deep and deeper still. And the same voice that moved upon the waters says, come dream and have your fill. In the stillness, I can hear you whisper, calling deep and deeper still. And the same says come. all of creation groans for the living God. We long to hear your voice. We long for your presence. So come and sweep over us like a river now. Come and sweep over us like a river now. Sweep over us like a river now. I can hear you in the stillness when you're all around. I can hear your voice like a whisper growing into a sound that surrounds like many waters. It takes over everything. Your voice pulls me deeper into the river of your presence. Till it's you and me. Don't give in to the fear. Don't look to the right or to the left. Keep your eyes on me. Now it's not the time to shut your heart to me. Now it's not the time to shut your ears to me. Into the river, who will come and drink deeply, to drink deeply. Will you come to me when I call you? Will you open to me when I call you? Will you come to me? It's not what you thought it would be. Will you come to me when I call you? I'm calling you now. I'm calling you now. It's time to rise. I'm calling you now. It's time to immerse yourself in the river. Thank you. into the river of your presence. In the stillness, I can hear you whisper, calling deep and deeper still. And the same voice that moved upon the waters says, come drink and have your fill. In the stillness, I can hear you whisper, calling deep and deeper still. And the same voice that moved upon the waters says, come drink and have your fill.
You are God, God of all creation. if it's physically possible, can we just, as brothers and sisters in the Lord, can we just stand to attention, almost like a prophetic gesture of our spirit man coming in to agreement with this declaration? And we all need to be singing this because it's a declaration of truth. And right now you might be saying, well, my heart's really not burning. But as we confess it, the confession of our mouth, saying this is what we ought to live, this is what we're called to live, and cause that spirit man to just stand in attention to the King, Jesus. Cause our hearts to burn
Jesus
for you.
In my heart.
Yes, personalize it. My heart. It burns, God. It burns for the living God. Flame, to renew the fire that burns within our hearts for the things that burn within yours. We ask in the name of Jesus for a renewing of a fire, of a burning that can only be birthed from your spirit, for that place of intimacy with your Son Jesus. We ask, oh God, that you would raise up the burning ones in this hour. Those that know their God, you said a smoldering wick you will not extinguish. You will fan the flame. You will not despise. You will blow on its embers and create a bonfire. Let our hearts burn for you in this hour, Jesus.
Jesus in my heart burns for you.
Saints assembled said, amen, amen. The so be it of God. Thank you, team.
Welcome.
Before we get into it, I just want to say some things on the front end. And for me, let me just put this little disclaimer out there. I feel like this is still a part of worship. But for those of you that know me and been around here for as long as we have been around here, 20 years now, we've been plowing and been faithful to what the Lord has assigned us to, playing that instrument in a huge symphony. And again, the point is that we just want to play it well in faithfulness. But you know that the number 22 is very special to me, and it's something that kind of like the Lord has always spoken me through, that number. And I'm not going to go down that path. That's not the point. But today is the 22nd. And so I say that because I believe that honor is a spiritual principle. And it's something that I believe that is all throughout the Word of God, that He puts in His word that we would recognize and honor those things that He honors. And when we do that, it brings Him not only great pleasure, it does something to us as it enlarges the 10 pegs of our hearts to be able to contain that which He releases, even in the act of honoring. Is this making sense? There was a girl that came in here some years back now, just a single woman, young, and she came in with a flute. And I saw that in the corner of my eye, and I thought, wow, that's interesting. And so I asked her to play, and she did it, you know. And then we didn't see her for a little bit, and then she came back, and she got hooked on Jesus. And that young woman became a fine, godly woman married to Stephen Petrie, and is an incredible woman of God and a mother of four. And she's been faithful to lead day in, day out here, every Friday, every Monday. As you can see, even tonight, the only vocal, but that's all we need. She's good enough. But her birthday's tomorrow. And as you all know, I'm speaking of Katie Petrie. And for those of you that, again, when I get it, I'm just saying this out, you know, I know some people are watching on Facebook, but this is worth it for me, that one of my favorite shows, when I get a chance to watch it, I just love American Pickers. I love the fact that those guys go in and they find these things that other people would think is, and they turn out to be sometimes worth thousands of dollars. And Katie, you're one of those treasures that God has brought to this place that we are so, so thankful and grateful for. And I thank God that He picked you and planted you here. And we are so blessed. And I would like to just have us all sing happy birthday to this woman of God who carries so much here and ushers us into the presence of the Lord. We just want to honor you, Katie Petrie. So if we can just sing, let's just stand and sing happy birthday to us, to her. And don't rely on me to sing. Trust me. Trust me. Thank you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Katie. Happy birthday to you. Yes. You are a blessing to be a spiritual daughter. I tell you, you're awesome. It's a pleasure to know you. Me and Julianne know you as a wife and as a friend, to see how you've raised your kids and so forth. You're just an amazing woman. You're welcome. Okay, with that said, it's fitting. Are you kind of warm there, Katie? The fire, right? It was the fire. We prayed about the fire. I want to talk a little bit on the front end about worship, and we'll see how far we get into this. But that's what I want to use tonight as a kind of like a launching pad. But worship, this is real basic stuff. It really is. But I want to build a something here. But worship is it's an inward emotion or a feeling, and an outward action that reflects the worth of God. And really, that inward emotion, that inward feeling is the centerpiece and essence. And I say that because Jesus said in Isaiah 19, he says, "You honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me." So that inward emotion is, that inward feeling is very important. It's kind of like the centerpiece. Because it does, it causes that outward action that will begin to reflect the worth of God, if that makes sense. So worship creates a space for us to experience that tangible presence of God. It creates that space for us. And I really believe that's what we're all called to, is coming to a place that we can tangibly experience the presence of the one that we love. When worship is reduced to duty, it ceases to exist. Why? Because you can't worship what you don't worship. Does that make sense? And Psalm 100, verse 4, is really an incredible roadmap that the Lord has put into his word is a roadmap into his presence. Psalm 100, verse 4, that's like a roadmap. He said, here it is. And as we know, for those of you that know that verse, it's very popular. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. So thanksgiving and praise, they're tools to strengthen ourselves, not because we get something from God, but because they reconnect us to our primary purpose, and that is to minister to God. They're tools, but not for us to extract things from God, but they enable us to do that which we are created to do, to worship him in truth and spirit. And for the Christian, worship is coextensive already to life, because life already is an expression of worship. You can't divorce the two, if that makes sense. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I was talking on the subject of hearing the voice of the Lord and why it's so important, critical, especially with present times and what's happening, why it's important to hear his voice. And the fact that I also mentioned that we live in a generation that's very unique, and it's unique in the sense it's a generation of voices. There's so many voices vying for our attention and vying for our approval just by the click of a finger. There's so many different perspectives, so many different opinions, and so forth. And because of the technology that we have today, the world has now become the media's church. And the talk show hosts are the prophets, actors and musicians, and celebrities are now the pastors and the ministers. And any script will do for the scriptures as long as truth and moral constraints are removed. And any of us who know anything about what's going on in the world would understand what I'm trying to say here. And our people that are not hearing God but being swayed and moved by what they're hearing externally, not from what the Lord's saying in here. And I would hope that in the body of Christ, I guess I could speak from that perspective, I would hope that we would all know the danger and the repercussions that certainly will follow when truth and moral constraints are removed from reason and from language. And that being reality is lost. Are you with me? when language and reason are violated and without boundary lines of the truth and moral constraints, reality is lost. And I'm not trying to be political here. That's not the point. But let me just give you one. There's some things that are happening out there that are so blatant. You can't help but use it as a great example. Here's what I'm talking. Here's an example. Removing or defunding law enforcement. Now, the language being used and the reasoning behind it is causing reality to be lost. Because history is a very ugly, grim reminder of what happens to those who think they have no law but themselves. And I don't think it's a coincidence that we're even trying to remove history. But we know. We know what happens when things like that take place. I know that none of us here were probably, well, maybe, I don't know, probably not, but were alive going what was happening in World War II and the genocide that was taking place then, but certainly most of us were alive to see what was happening in Rwanda. See, things like that happen when people believe that they have no law but to themselves. And that's what I mean when language and reason are removed and the boundary lines of truth and moral constraints are removed, language and reasons are violated, reality is lost. And what's mind-boggling is that it's becoming popular to think that way. And the Lord's saying, in this hour, as we're hearing his voice, we're called to be a people of wisdom and understanding, not just simply well-informed with surpluses of facts and figures. And there's a huge gap between knowledge and opinion. How many of us know that? And for so long, I'm talking about the church now, we've been short on wisdom and knowledge, and we've been very long on opinion. And the danger is when we allow our lives to be robbed of experience, like those times of worship and the feeling of presence, when we rob ourselves from experience, we're left with just being able to echo facts and echo principles. That's all we're left with because they're just facts and principles. We're just echoes. We're parrots. And really, that is the heart and soul of religion. When they're just facts and it's devoid of experience, which means it has no form. It's form without power is what that means. And we know that the Apostle Paul talks about that, having a form of godliness but denying the power. The power comes from experience. The power comes from men and women coming into his presence, feeling the faithfulness and the holiness and the purity of who God is. And in that times and in those places of encountering, our emotional chemistry being changed, and we leave totally different than what we came in. That's why the experience is so important. And my point is, I'm not sure if it's occurred to you, but I hope it has. The war has totally escalated and it's totally blatant now. We are in a war. And I'm talking first and foremost about a spiritual war. It's always been going on, but now it's more prevalent because it's beginning to manifest on the earth. It's touching the earth and we're seeing what's taking place. None of us would have had a good word for what's going on in Seattle 3.5 months ago, let alone 2 months ago. And the atrocities that the media is not reporting of the looting and raping and things like that is taking place of the citizens that were trapped in there. So I say all that because when I began with worship, because worship is God's number one strategy. It's his preemptive strike against the enemy's onslaught that he's releasing upon the earth. It's worship. Now you would say, well, it's prayer. No. Worship and prayer are two sides of the same coin in God's economy. You can't separate worship and prayer because most of the Psalms were sung prayers. Are you following me so far? And it's very important that the church understands how to fight spiritual warfare. the way that God has laid it out in his word. We are called to worship in spirit and truth. We are called to experience the goodness of God and to be a people of wisdom and understanding. And again, I said this the other week, and it behooves me to say this again tonight. The Lord is moving his people from a place of believing to a place of knowing. And that's the undertow. That's what's happening right now. When people are becoming, you know, coming into his presence, the Lord is causing this revelation to come upon them that it's transcending from a place of believing, which is nothing. We all start there, and there's nothing wrong with that. But there is a difference between believing and knowing, and that difference is the experience. I know. Like Job said, I've seen with my own eyes. You see, he believed it, which is good. We all live there. That's good. But there's something that happens when we begin to experience it ourselves. It's kind of echoed in the book of Jude when it says, build yourself up in your holy faith. Those experiences that you've cultivated with God. And I felt like, you know, we need to understand how to engage in God-centered spiritual warfare. And I know that may sound very elementary, but obviously maybe it is, but obviously we're still not getting the clue. But again, the pendulum is swinging. And the Lord's people is beginning to hearken and spend time between the porch and the altar. There's so many men and women of God that are filling the church, and I'm talking about in leadership, that are devoid of the prayer closet. And I'm not, it's not about shaming. It's just about saying what it is. And the Lord said, this is a time in an hour in which you and I, he's calling us to engage and make a difference in the generation in which we live. To make an impact, to begin to leak his kingdom and see a transformation take place to where there are people who had no clue about who Jesus is and they come into encounter with him and begin to worship him as the only one and true God. And so worship is an agreement with who God is. That's primarily what worship is. And again, this is simplistic. I'm just saying it for definition's sake. Worship is our response to his presence. Thanksgiving is our response to what he's done. And praise is our response to who he is. So you have worship, praise, and thanksgiving. Then we have intercession, what we do. And intercession is agreement with what he promises to do, who he says he is, and those kind of things. That's what we intercede from. That is our foundation. It's releasing his spirit for revival, releasing his spirit for justice, all those things from that position, knowing that he is the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, and his throne has never been in jeopardy of being usurped. And his kingdom knows no end, which means it's constantly advancing. It's never shrunk back, ever. No matter what the media is telling you. Just like when ISIS was running on a rampage, a few years back. Oh, doom and gloom. Oh, no. The kingdom was still advancing. The kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our God. And if we're throwing in intercession, we might as well throw in some repentance in here. And what that is just breaking our agreement with sin and breaking our agreement with lies. And in other words, we engage in spiritual warfare by agreeing with God and disagreeing with the enemy. That really is what it is in simplistic terms. I say all that because somebody asked, we talked about this before, and I'll just say it here tonight as well. Where are we at in the timeline of human history? I believe that we're in a place of not the birth pangs yet, but I believe we're dealing with morning sickness. I believe that's where the body of Christ is. For those who have ears, let them hear. And the scriptures clearly tell us, like a good leader would, he told us that these things shall take place. But be of good cheer and be at peace because I've already overcame the world. And you guys know I've said this 100 times here. He doesn't describe what it's going to be like to say, wow, I hope you endure it. He says it because he wants us to change that environment with releasing his kingdom. Because contrast is the mother of clarity. When you have deep darkness covering the earth, he says, oh, that's okay, but so is my glory rising. Right? God describes it as deep darkness. But he says, I don't want you to focus on that. My glory is rising. Daniel says sin will ripen in that day. God says, that's okay, so is righteousness. I'm telling you, the church's greatest hour is not, it's happening now. It's happening, it truly is happening now. We couldn't see the things that we're about to see unless darkness was approaching and encroaching on the land. But God's, his righteousness is going forth. The scriptures tell us, as Jesus described the gospel, but also the book of Revelation, he tells us that it's going to be four primary cultural strongholds. And that's what I'm going to give us tonight. Four primary structural strongholds. Sin patterns, if you want to just simplify. They're sin patterns. And if you want the verse, the chapter and verse is chapter 9, verse 21. That's where you'll find these four cultural strongholds. Now, these cultural strongholds, its objective is to affect social injustice. Because our God is the only true just king. So the enemy's objective is to cause social injustice. In these four cultural strongholds, which I'm about to talk about. But these social injustices, terrorism, for example, prejudice, you know, racism, divorce, abuse, oppression, all those things I just mentioned, and there's a plethora of more. That's happening now. But it's at embryonic stages. It's nowhere near the level it's going to get. Is this making sense? You have individual organizations, you have governments that give expression to these four cultural strongholds, these sin patterns, which are these. Here's the four. And again, it's just in Revelation 9:21. It's very clear. He said there will be murder. Number two, sorcery. Number three, immorality. And number four, theft. All of this first starts in the heavens. That's where it all starts. Now, under the category murder, you have abortion, gangs, drug rings, organized crime, evil governments. Again, you have individuals, you have organizations, you have governments that give expression to the strongholds. For example, governments that operate with murderous legislation. For example, death camps, right? Or genocide. Ethnic cleansing. Those are governments that had merged legislation. Then you have sorceries, the second category. Occult groups, false religions, cults, demon worship, witchcraft, and you can add probably a few more. The third category was immoralities. And obviously, we all know how popular that is today. Adult entertainment, right? The porn industry, magazines, movies, prostitution, sex trafficking. Now, you guys, 50 years ago, if we were talking about this, some of this would be kind of foreign. But here we are, 2020, and it's happening in this country, let alone over the world. And again, let me just say this to this crowd, because I know I'm preaching to the choir. Most believers, when they hear things like this, because it really hasn't touched their little world yet, because we still don't get the fact that we were bought with a price, we're kind of like, yeah, okay, it's cool, but no big deal. It's a big deal to God. And this is why we began up front saying, God, what are those things that burn in your heart? That was our prayer. Because I want to connect with that, because in that is life. Even though it's a burden that's on your heart, it still brings me life. Because everything about God is life. It's not something that we should be afraid of or say, I'm not sure I want to touch that subject. God, you have no idea what you're missing out on. And that's the enemy's number one tactic, is to scare Christians of the fear of death. But I ask you, how in the world do you threaten somebody with heaven? That's where we're going to end up. We all signed up for it, whether we face it or not. But we were bought with a price. And it's coming into that reality of understanding that even when we look at the atrocities happening today to believers, I mean, I don't know if you keep up on this with martyrs and so forth. There's more martyrs that have been martyred today, this year, than all the other years combined in numbers. And we think, oh my gosh, what injustice. But I'm going to tell you, and it is, don't get me wrong, but here's the deal. He is so amazing that when we think that an 18-year-old or a 15-year-old or a 5-year-old's life is cut short, how tragic it is, don't get me wrong, but he is so amazing, it's not like when they enter into the throne room of who he is, they're not going to look at him and say, boy, I was ripped off. They're going to say, I've arrived. They are more alive there than we are here. When we go from this side of the age to the age to come, we are going to be more alive there than we ever were here. And that is the hope that we have as believers. It's a powerful reality. And the last category is theft. You have, you know, those. That's the last category in that we have, the theft. And when you're dealing with these kind of things, and dishonest gain, and again, murder, sorcery, immorality, those, and theft, those kind of things, the Lord has an answer for all those things. That's why he's raising up the prayer movement. That is the preemptive strike. Beloved, this is not a coincidence that this is exactly what was going on even before the dark ages took place. The Lord had a shining bright example of people that would stand before him day and night to minister before him. When the law governing, the government of the Roman Empire, when it had fallen, and it brought in the dark ages, God still had a standard that was there ministering him day and night. He's got people praying. And so, under the category murder, when we pray, the Lord is just saying, use words that I have in my heart that contain power, like life, mercy, justice, vengeance, and judgment. Those kind of things that we can pray according to the scriptures. And we are called to pray those kind of things because those are the four strong cultural, strongholds that is being released. And all four are operative right now. And I'll just say this, just to simplify, just in one place in Seattle, all four are being operative, let alone the world. And the church is not to be silent. Revenge is not the same thing as justice. God is not about revenge. He's about justice. He's about mercy. For mercy triumphs over judgment. And he wants a people that have been experiencing that in his presence, of realizing how much we've been forgiven and what we've been given, right, in Christ. It's just an amazing thing that what we have at our disposal and what the Lord is releasing. I'm so excited about what God is doing, and at the same time very sober, knowing what is also transpiring, knowing that there are some believers saying, I can't wait to go back to normal. Normal's not coming back. Nor do you want that normal compared to what he's doing, because he's clearing his throat. And when God steps in the room, even the things that we're doing right is going to change because he's holy. The accountability level has gone way up. And he's not picking sides. He's here to take over. And he's calling his bride to agree with his heart, to agree with those things that matter, to agree with those things that are upright and righteous, and live it out. Not just what we do in private, but what we do in public. And it's very important that we understand, Lord, how do we engage in that spiritual warfare? How do we engage in those kind of things? And again, the enemy uses these four cultural strongholds to keep the people of God not only silent, but in fear. And fear is just love in the wrong direction. Immorality is so, I believe that those four cultural strongholds, they're not in order of severity. In fact, I think the third one is mentioned in the book of Revelation, which is immorality. I think that's the enemy's number one strategy and his number one tool to use, because immorality is the counterfeit to intimacy. He knows it's God's heart to raise up a generation all across the globe, not just one isolated people group, all across the world, that will live out the first commandment first. Not in the top 10, I mean number one. And the enemy knows that. And that can only be fueled by intimacy. And in order for him to thwart that, like when he did when he was killing all the babies because he knew the king, the deliverer was coming, he's doing the same thing. I'm going to stop them from being able to see dreams and see visions by clouding their eyesight by immorality and get them entrapped in pornography and get them entrapped in all this kind of stuff. And the Lord said, no, I want your eyes to keep bright. I want you to make that covenant so that you could see clearly, so that you could see what I'm about to release on the earth, and that we would be like sons of Issachar, who not only know the signs and the seasons, but also walking in that kingship like David, who knows how to implement it to defeat all the enemies of God. But this time it's on the spiritual realm, not on the physical. Does that make sense? That's really all I have to say. So I'm going to ask Kay to come back up. Yeah, I'll just have the whole team, because I just want to lead us in on a prayer, if we could. But, beloved, listen. Pat, so good to see you again. Oh, my gosh. Intercessor goes way back. Just a woman of God. I kind of gave this charge last week, and I just want to say it again this week. I'm telling you, I realize that you can look at me and gauge, on 1 to 10 and give them a 0. I get that, but hear me. If there's anything that you could take away from this evening, it would be this. You are so deceived if you think that you could sit on the sidelines in this hour and get away with it. This is not the time to act like if I put my head in the sand, this thing's going to go away. Birth pangs are coming. We're just in morning sickness. But birth pangs are coming. And God's saying, I've called you to render powerless the works of the devil. I asked you as my bride to do this. And that's what we're called to do. Just go ahead and begin to play. That's what we're called to do. And I'm telling you, please get between the porch and the altar. Encounter your God. And say, Lord, I want to make an impact. And listen, if it's just one person, that's a game changer. But we can't stand on the sidelines waiting to see what's going to happen, to see which side we're going to fall. No. We already know. We read the back of the book. We know who wins. But we also want to know that we want to make an impact in the time frame in which we are living. That we'd be liking what he said to David in Acts chapter 13. David fulfilled all my will in his lifetime. I want that to be said of us. That generation knew me, and they fulfilled all my will. Right? If we could just stand, I just want to close this out in a word of prayer. And in this prayer, if you're one of those that says, you know what, I don't want to be on the sidelines. I really never thought about it. But I want to be in the game. And the Lord said, I've called you to be. I didn't call you to be the bench warmer. I called you to be used as a noble vessel for noble purposes. And if you want that, just declare it in your heart as we just end this in this evening with this prayer. And if somebody could get Stephen next door, that would be great. But Father, I just ask that in context of these four cultural strongholds, that you would release your vengeance on the spirit of murder, on the spirit of sorcery, immorality, and theft. Father, we just ask that you would bring about your justice to every enterprise, every endeavor, every business that promotes murder, sorcery, morality, and theft. We ask that your justice would come. We just declare your victory. We declare your light over darkness. We declare your glory over oppression. We declare your power over sickness. We speak your blood over sin. We speak your majesty over evil leadership. We declare the light of God, that it would go forth and vanquish darkness. Father, we ask that you would bring unity where there's division, that you would bring peace and clarity where there's confusion. In every camp of the enemy, God, that your kingdom would come like a beacon, oh God, that would dispel darkness. Dismantle the oppressor, we ask, in your Son's name, for your glory. For every person that is entrenched and entrapped and enslaved in darkness has been made in your image and has great value. So we speak life to that, Lord. We speak purpose to that. We speak a hope, a plan, and a future to them, that they would turn and find life when they embrace your Son, Jesus. I ask this in your name. Let's all sing this together. Let's join with the Heavenly Symphony right now. Sing day and night. You're worthy. You're worthy, Jesus. Singing, he's worthy of it all. He's worthy.
You're worthy of it all.
You're worthy, Jesus. You're worthy.
You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Day and night, night and day, let incense rise. want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. It's, as always, a pleasure to see you all, and thank you for joining us. If it's your first time, I just want to welcome you. A few announcements for you before we wrap up the night. I just want to remind you guys that we are going to be doing things a little different on the 4th of July weekend, that Friday night, which is the 3rd, so the day before 4th of July. We're still going to be here and worshiping, and it's going to be a great time, but we're going to do just an hour. We're going to cut the worship a little short, and then we're going to do a barbecue right afterwards and just celebrate the goodness that God has poured out on us as a nation. And obviously, there's a lot to still be grateful for, even with all the craziness going on in the world today. So we just want to take some time that night to have fun and get to know each other and just hang out a little bit. And so we've done that. We did that a couple years ago. I think it was 2 years ago, if I'm not mistaken. And it was a lot of fun. So we're going to do that. We're going to provide the meat and everything. But if you're coming, we would love it if you would bring some kind of side dish to pass. That would be great. You don't have to, but if you can, it'll just it'll make for more food, which is always a good thing, in my opinion. So anyway, so we're looking forward to that. Also, just want to encourage you guys, come out Mondays and Fridays, and just remind you, we do live stream all the sessions. So the teachings, if you've missed any, you can go back and watch them. But I really have just been blessed by what Todd has been sharing. And so I like to go back and re-listen to them, or Friday nights I actually re-watch, and it's just awesome. So I want to thank you guys. As always, we are just so grateful as a house of prayer to those of you that sow into the house of prayer. Keep it going through your financial gifts and offerings. Those of you that are watching on Facebook, for you that have given, I just want to say we are so grateful. And so thank you all for that. If you don't know how to give, you can go to the website at chaihop.org. You can give there. That also has information on how you can give via texting. And there's always the door. The box by the door where you can put cash or check if you like to give that way, or mail it to us if that's easier for you guys. So, God bless you. We thank you, Father. I just thank you for tonight, Lord. I thank you for this place, the opportunity to come together with brothers and sisters in the Lord to lift up your name, Jesus, to worship you, to stand in unity and agree with your heart, Lord. I just thank you for the word that came out that Todd gave tonight. Lord, I ask that we would all be people that would press into your heart in this time and hear your voice, just as he was talking about tonight, that we would shine your light, Lord, in the midst of the darkness. And so, God, I just thank you for this house of prayer. So you bless it. Bless those that are here tonight, those that are watching on Facebook. In Jesus' name, amen.